Hey, quick reminder that I have a Patreon page. I would love to be making more videos more consistently, but production takes a lot of time when I have to do all of it on my own. If I had more financial support from patrons, I would be able to make more content that we all enjoy. So yeah, please consider it if you're able. Okay, back to the video.
More than 20 animal species were identified as having gone extinct in 2019. So today I thought we should dig into the details about how species are listed as endangered and what that means for their protection. Ask basically any ecologist or conservation biologist, and they'll probably tell you that we are in the midst of a biodiversity crisis. Some experts are even going so far as to say that we are in the middle of our planet's sixth mass extinction. That would put us in league with other mass extinctions that were caused by enormous volcanic eruptions, asteroid impacts, and other periods of dramatic climate change. Things are real bad, but that's not always easy to see, especially given the size of our planet and how complicated numbers are. For instance, is 700 wild cheetahs enough? What about 7,000 or 10,000? And how do we know what enough cheetahs is? Well, there are several ways we can talk about numbers and how those species are doing. But the most important thing to remember here is that all of these methods are based on human values. Let's take a look at what I mean. I live in the United States, where we have the groundbreaking Endangered Species Act that was signed into law in 1973 by Richard Nixon. So there was actually a point in time when the Endangered Species Act gives organizations like the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and NOAA Fisheries the ability to list species as threatened, which is kind of bad, or endangered, which is really bad. Listings can also be submitted by petitions written by other groups of people, but those have to go through a longer approval process. Once a species is listed under the Endangered Species Act, it's protected from further habitat loss, illegal taking or harvesting of any kind, and government agencies are responsible for working to protect and rehabilitate the species, all with the goal that eventually the species can be delisted because its numbers are robust enough to no longer need protection. Well, that sounds like a pipe dream, especially when we consider that many of the species listed under the Endangered Species Act are there because they've lost too much habitat. I can't imagine that we're just going to get rid of Fresno and give the land back to the San Joaquin kit foxes, or give huge swaths of Florida back to the Florida panthers. So it seems like once a species is listed, it might be stuck on the list. That's not to say there haven't been success stories. A subpopulation of gray whales, as well as a subpopulation of Steller sea lions, had both been listed as endangered in the 70s and 90s, respectively. Both were also listed as recovered after about 20 years, so there is evidence that we can fix things. Of course, when I was looking for delisted species, I also found the Caribbean monk seal, which had been listed as endangered in the 60s and delisted in the early 2000s because it had gone extinct. So yeah, mixed results. Part of the reason for these mixed results is, of course, because these systems are designed by us humans and operate at the whim of our values. The Endangered Species Act has been at the heart of several fights over whether or not economic interests should be taken into account when listing and working to protect species. Like I said, we're not going to give Fresno back to the foxes. So depending on our values, there may not be much we can or will do to protect some species. But let's take a more global look at how we evaluate and list endangered species. While the Endangered Species Act is specific to the United States, the IUCN's Red List covers the entire world. The IUCN, or International Union for Conservation of Nature, was founded in 1964 and presents guidelines for evaluating the health of species. All assessments must be carried out by experts, and unlike the Endangered Species Act, where subpopulations of species can be listed, IUCN assessments must be made on an entire species' numbers. The experts must also use the most current data and published literature available when making their assessments. The IUCN has 9 different levels for listing species: not evaluated, data deficient, least concern, near threatened, vulnerable, endangered, critically endangered, extinct in the wild, and extinct. While it's absolutely important to see where species fall on the continuum between least concern and extinct, I actually think it's more interesting to see how many species, and which species, are stuck at not evaluated or data deficient. The designation data deficient is pretty self-explanatory. Basically, we just don't have enough information for those species to know whether or not they're threatened. This category has over 16,000 species on the red list. And spoiler alert, if we don't have enough data to evaluate species like the southern Honduran spiny-tailed iguana, or the violet-spotted reef lobster, or the aptly named scarce fritillary, it may be because they're already so rare in the wild that it's difficult to collect data on them. There's another possible reason, though, and this probably accounts for many of the data-deficient species, and probably almost all of the not evaluated species. We have limited resources. There are only so many researchers who can work on evaluations, and those researchers have limited time, money, and other resources with which to run evaluations. There's no possible way we could catalog and evaluate all living things on Earth. So how do we choose which ones we prioritize? Well, it looks like we're back to talking about values again. Think about the endangered species you've heard of or are worried about. Do they look like this, or this, or this? That's not surprising. These are big animals with widespread cultural appeal, also known as charismatic megafauna, and they're often used as symbols for conservation efforts. They're also vertebrates, or animals with backbones, like us. Why are all of the most famous endangered species vertebrates? I call this phenomenon facism, or more appropriately, non-facism. Humans are naturally attracted to animals with faces and bodies more like ours. The less like a human something looks, the less likely we are to like it or care about it. And our facist values are reflected in how we choose to consider and protect the other species on our planet. The World Wildlife Fund's species directory lists only one invertebrate, the monarch butterfly, but with no status given. The most recent IUCN listing from 2013 marks monarchs as least concern. The Endangered Species Act has a section on plants, but the emphasis of the bulk of the legislation seems to be aimed primarily at animals, and especially at vertebrates. And while the IUCN's red list includes animals, plants, and fungi, it's easy to see that vertebrate animals are still given priority by researchers, governments, and funding sources. Before the arguments start in the comments section, yes, fungi are notoriously difficult to differentiate into species, and invertebrates are often small and hard to find. But these small, non-vertebrate organisms make up a vast portion of the biodiversity on Earth, as well as participating in most of the vital ecosystem functions that make our world livable. So what do you think about the ways our societal values influence our willingness and ability to care for the other species on Earth? Have you recognized your own facist tendencies, or do you love the unloved things? Have you been inspired to toss a coin to your researchers so that more species can receive red list evaluations? I'd love to hear your thoughts down in the comments. If you liked this video, don't forget to like it. If you didn't like this video, please share it with someone who would. And if you'd like to support The Roving Naturalist, remember to hit the subscribe button and the bell notification icon. Then go check out my Patreon page. You can also follow me on Twitter and Instagram. If you're a big fan of biodiversity, you'll definitely want to check out my science-themed Dungeons & Dragons show, Nature Check, on Twitch. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.